Welcome back to more Mass Effect 3. I'm the RPG Chick. For this episode, we're... well, this and... two or three episodes. Shouldn't be that much, depending on how much their content there is to see. We're going to be checking out four systems. Now, I looked at this off-screen. There are two systems on which... we, have quests. Calliston Rift for the Leviathan DLC, and Krogan DMZ for all this Krogan stuff. And there's actually one or two more things than are listed on label there. We have a lot to do in the Krogan DMZ. But that's going to be our final destination. Before that, doing Leviathan, but before that even, going to be checking out four other systems on which we don't have quests. Now, I could do that in Leviathan. I mean, it's entirely possible that our quest for Leviathan will send us to these other systems at some point. Obviously, I don't know, playing blind here, so. Or not. But either way, we're going to read the planet descriptions and search for artifacts and goodies and such in those systems. And there are four of them. There's Gemini Sigma, Hades Gamma, over here, Minos Wasteland, and Crescent Nebula. So we're gonna check those out. And away we go. Okay, we've also got... ooh. Right off. I hear it. We've got a Ming system here, too.
Signal confirmed.
Oh, that was delayed. But really, not much. That's as far as we're gonna get there. That's pretty cool. Okay, so we got 470 units of fuel, which we didn't need because we're full. But still, it shows us this is only one asset left. Now, I was going to do the Leviathan DLC first, but I only have a couple hours before I have to start recording and go to bed and all that fun stuff. So, I'll do this and wrap it up. Leviathan, and then Tuchanka, various quests there, including the main quest. So we've got Ming. We've got two systems, okay. So we should be able to get to the next system, you know, in this episode anyway. So I got Paravin. Paravin is a small, unremarkable rock world. The surface is scorching hot and mainly composed of calcium with deposits of aluminum. Paravin's low mass has left it tidally locked to the star Han. I remember that, like Han Solo. If there are any resources of value, mining stations could be established on the relatively temperate Twilight Band. I just realized it's called Han. We've seen this system in at least one of the other games. Huntingtoe. Huntingtoe is a Jovian-sized gas giant with a standard hydrogen-helium atmosphere. Traces of methane give the planet its distinct cobalt-blue tint. Spectral analysis indicates its extensive ring system is mostly composed of ice crystals. Huntingtoe has an exceptionally powerful magnetic field, which creates strong radio interference throughout the inner system. And that's it. We don't have to scroll. Alright, so we started with the first planet, yeah, so third, Mavagon. These are pretty short descriptions. Mavagon is a small rock and ice planet with a thin atmosphere of ammonia and methane. The surface is frozen and mainly composed of tin with deposits of potassium. The planet has a rudimentary ammonia-based life, mainly concentrated around geothermal vents deep underground. Severe storm cycles are common. Due to limited visibility, navigation may be difficult. Well, we're not landing there. Yeah, and no notes on the Reapers being in this system. Maybe they haven't even gone to this system. They're hanging out in Ming or something. Fourth planet. Far Crothu. It's interesting names. A standard gas, hydrogen, helium, gas giant. This is a little gas and gas. It's a little, what do we call it? Redundant? Far Crothu is only distinguished by its moons. Several dozens of them have been sculpted into the likenesses of an anthropodal alien race not yet known to Council science. Arthropodal. Radiometric dating suggests the moons were worked over 500,000 years ago. Protheans, maybe? And the fifth and last planet from the sun is here. Patatanlis. Whoops. Patatanlis is a large rock world with an unusually thin atmosphere of hydrogen and carbon monoxide. The frigid world's crust contains extensive deposits of uranium and occasional loads of naturally occurring plutonium. With a total mass more than four times that of Earth, Patatanlis should have a significantly thicker atmosphere. This unusual feature has flagged it as worthy of scientific investigation, but the need for expensive amounts of radiation shielding has deterred interest. Alright. Now the other one is probably on a world. I wonder if I sit here if I can hit all three of these. I don't know. I doubt it's going to be on the gas giants. We don't ever find anything there. Oh! Hold up! It's unrealistic that we're able to do this. But I want to find everything, so do it we will. It's somewhere... I really have to move the mouse a far distance sometimes. Probe away. Salvage, 10,000 credits we got. Okay, where do I head? Away from the Reapers and towards the edge as quickly as possible. Oh. Ming.
Evasion successful.
Cool. Always a good thing. I like evasion. Wow, this is far. This is like that other planet we were in a couple episodes ago. Asgard, far away from, only got three planets here. Asgard, which is... Yeah, originally came from Utopia. We actually have another item to find in Asgard. Let me just check this. Well, flying rapidly around here. Checking the asteroid belt. Alright. Check out planets. Antiropus. Death to Ming! Antiropus is a hydrogen-helium gas giant that formed in the outer regions of Ming's system and is in the process of migrating inwards. In a few million years, the planet's atmosphere will begin to boil away into space. There is a sizable temperature difference between the side of Antiropus facing the energetic blue giant primary and the side facing the cold of deep space. This variance powers massive cyclonic wind systems. The intense heat it absorbs from the sun, in addition to its own internal heat engine, causes the planet's dark side to radiate faintly in the infrared. I don't see it radiating. Parag. Parag is a large rock planet with an atmosphere composed of nitrogen and argon. Despite lying over 600 AU from Ming, its surface is scorching hot and mainly composed of alumina with deposits of silver. Due to the radiation and heat, landing on Parag's sunward side with anything less than warship-grade shielding will likely be fatal. Parag rotates at a retrograde to the rest of the Ming system, indicating it is likely a captured body. 2G gravity. Finally, Altanork is a small but typical hydrogen-helium gas giant with no outstanding features. Its combination of strong magnetic field and relatively shallow gravity well make it a popular stopover world for discharging FTL drive cores. Alright. Search for goodies. What? One.
I found something.
320 units of fuel, God. Oh my God. They're gonna come from here, too. Sheesh. Starts the scanner. We'll head west. Probe away. Alliance cruiser Nairobi. And Alliance. Oh, that's part of Alliance 3rd Fleet then. Subheading or whatever. Yay, let's get the hell out of here!
Reapers done. Eluded.
And we're almost full of fuel, nice. Oh, jeez. Gemini Sigma, complete! Oh crap.
Faster than light jump successful.
I forgot they'd do that. Alright. Let me just see if there's a... If I can't fuel up here, I'm gonna have to... go back. Oh, I hear that. I can't fuel up here, so I'm gonna have to go back, but first...
Signal confirmed.
300 units of fuel, is that enough? Oh wait, let me see. I exited out too quickly. We have 853. Let's try to work with this. They aren't that far away, these other systems. We're still like barely aware of us or something. Alright, so Antaeus. In the Hades Gamma system, right? Am I correct? Hades Gamma, yeah. Oh wow, there's five systems. Okay, innermost planet. A gecko. It's a gecko. During the initial survey of the Antaeus system, only a single flyby probe was spared for the small, scorched world of a gecko. It revealed a planet unusually rich in heavier elements given its size. A gecko is a standard terrestrial with a thin atmosphere of krypton and xenon. Its crust is mainly composed of magnesium with deposits of cobalt and other heavy metals. Due to extremely tough, cratered terrain, starships are discouraged from landing. Second planet from the sun, Trebin. Trebin is a modest terrestrial world with an atmosphere composed of nitrogen and argon. Its surface is mainly composed of nickel with deposits of silver. Trebin's environment is relatively mild, but the scarcity of water or similar enabling substances has prevented the development of any biosphere. Exogeny Corp recently performed a test impact of a single water ice comet into the surface, the first step of a long-term plan to thicken the atmosphere and introduce water to the environment. A survey team is on the surface monitoring the geological and meteorological effects of the test impact. Most of the water released is still in the form of atmospheric vapor, but thick cloud banks have formed. There is every indication that this arid world will soon see its first rain. The survey team's progress has been hampered by frequent mechanical or computer failures in their GPS satellites. Third planet, gas giant Edmos. Edmos is a standard hydrogen-helium gas giant with traces of methane in its atmosphere. If Treban's terraforming is successful, it is expected that a helium-3 fuel refining facility for the system will be set up here. Very close by, Ploba. Ploba is the second and by far the larger of Antaeus's two gas giants. Active scans by survey ships have returned tantalizing indications of massive solid structures deep within the atmosphere, too regular in pattern to be anything natural. Some believe Ploba is a Jupiter brain, a planet-sized supercomputer. Cool. I think we have to scan by this planet. Adherents of this theory have fruitlessly beamed signals toward the sunken megastructures, hoping to get the machine's attention. Others believe that an ancient spacefaring race disposed of their weapons of war by dumping them into the planet. The last attempt to reach and salvage Ploba's deep anomalies went tragically wrong and ended with a crew of 12 being trapped and crushed in the gas giant's lower atmosphere. Yeah, it's dangerous. You don't want to hang out in a gas giant. Alright. Vamal. Vamal is an enormous terrestrial world of mixed rock and ice with an atmosphere of methane and ethane. Its frozen surface is mainly composed of calcium with deposits of iron. Because of noxious surface gases, explorers are warned to use extreme caution. Unidor. Unidor is a moderately sized ice world with an extremely thin atmosphere composed of krypton and xenon. Its frozen surface is unusually smooth, suggesting widespread repaving by cryovolcanic processes, though no such activity is currently evident. Alright, what can we find? This is a big system. You know, our next one's probably going to be a planet. Let's get in the middle of these three. Got something? Scanner. Right here, nice. Probe launched. Credits recovered. Salvage. Cool. Now we're done with this system. And they're not onto us, which is good. It means we could safely come back here and use the mass relay when we're done. I remember Farinata and all these planets. Systems, I mean. Yeah. We can go either way, really. Let's go clockwise. Hit Plutusk. Hopefully in some of these systems we'll find fuel to enable us to keep going. Plutus. Gotta check out the asteroid belt here. Okay, nothing found. First planet, Mingito? Mingito? Mingito is a sun-baked wasteland of sodium chlorates and radioactives. Its relatively light mass has left it tidally locked to the star Plutus, with a day-side hot pole and a night-side cold pole. The powerful solar wind has stripped most of the atmosphere away. Second planet from the sun, Maedla. Maedla is a terrestrial planet with a light atmosphere of carbon dioxide and hydrogen sulfide. The surface is hot and mainly composed of magnesia with deposits of sulfur. Over a dozen volcanoes are currently erupting across the surface. I guess there's really nothing to interest the Reapers here. I don't even know why they're in these systems. But yeah, there's no descriptions of them, you know, destroying planets or that they've done this and that. Clocrolis is a modest rock planet roughly the size of Mars. It has a thin atmosphere of carbon dioxide and ethane. Its scorching hot surface is mainly composed of silicate rock with deposits of aluminum and other light metals. Clocrolis has a very weak magnetic field. In addition to very high levels of solar radiation, it is not suitable for Mass Effect drive discharge operations. Nonual? Though it is one of the oldest entries in the star charts, Nonual has not been fully mapped. It is the largest body in the asteroid belt of the blue star Plutus, not only large enough to maintain a spherical shape, but also massive enough to retain the noxious carbon and sulfur dioxides venting from its many volcanoes as an atmosphere. Nonual is rapidly volcanic, and the source of its great heat is also the source of its inordinate mass. Nonual is a secondary source of element zero, coalesced around a large chunk of Ezo, ejected by a supernova billions of years ago. I kind of miss, you know, scanning for, like, Ezo and plutonium, whatever else. Surface conditions are extremely hazardous. In addition to the thin crust and numerous magma flows, wide stretches of the landscape are coated with slippery ash and cinders ejected from the volcanoes. This is not a very friendly system. Last one is over here. Vayaria. Vayaria is a huge hydrogen helium gas giant with traces of methane in its atmosphere. Best description ever. Alright. Let's see if we can find anything. Waiting for that sound. Not hearing anything. Whoops. What am I doing? Nothing, huh? Might be all on the planets. Possibly. Gotta check out the planets. Who knows? Maybe there might be just one.
I found something.
Somewhere this way. Probe launched. Special Ops Team Zeta. Cool. For 103rd Marine Division. Hopefully it's the only asset. It is. Okay, cool. Not completely alerted yet. We'll continue on our journey here.